100% of bone marrow was warranted. So that was done. Initially we expected a aplastic anemia, but instead we had a cellular marrow. 40% cellularity for a 60-year-old man is considered normal, with adequate erythropoiesis. Megakaryocytes were reduced. And when we did the autoimmune workup, his ANA was positive. We did not see any cancer, and in this case the cause of pancytopenia was a autoimmune pancytopenia. Granulocyte colony stimulating factor.
Increasing the WBC.
Yeah. Myelopoiesis, it stimulates that. So if the WBC is low, we use it in cancer and everything, it stimulates marrow recovery is a bit quicker. People are using it, unwarranted use is also going on, but that is not recommended to use GCSF till we know the cause of the leukopenia.
And what is
Eltrombopag is a similar drug. It stimulates your megakaryocytes to increase the platelets. It is used extensively, and in fact the only licensed indication is used in ITP, immune thrombocytopenic purpura. So sometimes it may be even classical, young boy presented with high grade fever, bruising in legs, severe pallor. They are all very short histories, they don't give a long history, you know, well, 2 weeks ago went for holiday, suddenly feeling pale and weak. So hemoglobin 7, MCV was normal, total count was only 400 and platelets 4000. And when you look at the peripheral blood smear, not always, because the total count is only 400, you may not see a full acute leukemia picture. You may see an occasional atypical lymphocytes. Now most of the peripheral labs, where they are there, nobody will commit and say that there is a blast in the blood picture. They will leave the comment as atypical lymphocyte, okay, because they are not very sure. So that atypical lymphocyte should be taken seriously, especially if you have got a pancytopenia, because very few labs will confidently say that that is a blast cell. So here there were again no questions, bone marrow was done, and it was a classic acute lymphoblastic leukemia. We are treating several patients here with acute lymphoblastic leukemia with standard ALL protocols, and in children they have an excellent outcome. Adults generally require a bone marrow transplant if the prospect of cure has to be considered. Otherwise the disease eventually tends to relapse. But children, over 90% cure rates are there. So this one, yeah, another different thing, elderly gentleman, frail, cachectic, presented with anemia. Hemoglobin was 6, again MCV is normal, total count 1300 and platelet 42,000. You look at the peripheral smear, no abnormal cells were seen. So you think about aplastic anemia. We still do the hematinics, they were normal. So again, no questions, we don't know the cause of this pancytopenia, a bone marrow was done. And in this case, you see, it's showing a big infiltrate of cells, with which we can say that this is not coming from the hematopoietic system. It's a non-hematopoietic infiltrate. That means some other cancer or anything in the blood has come and filled up your marrow space, and it's not allowing the normal bone marrow cells to generate, so causing a pancytopenia. So you have to then evaluate what these cells are. So we do the tumor markers and PET scan. And one of the most common diseases which metastasizes to the bone is prostate cancer. So, in fact, he had no symptoms of urine. I mean, a 70-year-old man, little bit urinary symptoms, they all have expected. But then, gradually, you know, this is what a regular health screening packages are trying to do, is pick up patients early on, because metastatic cancer prostate, the treatments is still good, even with stage 4 now. People can have a reasonable length of life.
Primary serous prostate.
Yes, with metastasis to the bone. Yeah. So
PSA
was very high.
The patient didn't have any symptoms.
Not many, little bit. Mild. Like mild 70-year-old will have little urinary disturbances, but nothing else. So presented only with anemia.
Being low weight,
they may have, but see, the thing is, all these symptoms are very non-specific in a 70-year-old. I've got a little back pain. Yes, that is why it's important to do your basic regular screening, health screening for all these patients, because some of them are picked up only on blood tests. So this one is something we see. young boy, 5-year-old, weakness, lethargy, hemoglobin was 8 gram at local place. Now most people in villages expect all anemia to be iron deficiency. So they will all come after a trial of Kulekhara leaves, and in fact somebody told me there are now Kulekhara tablets also available. Like they started...
Ramdev.
But they do try, so they gave him Kulekhara for two months, and there was no improvement. And gradually they started noticing bruising on the legs.
So what is the Kulekhara actually?
Kulekhara is a leaf.
Green leaf like
leaves. Just like
saag. Saag.
It's like a saag.
So now the, like papaya leaves came as carry pill tablets. Even Kulekhara they have made it into business and got some tablets. So blood count was, when he came to us, hemoglobin was 6.3. Total count is 800 and platelets 7. So this is not iron deficiency, and they, the only, the other problem is they only do hemoglobin. Yes. So they will release only hemoglobin 8, that has no value, absolutely no value in finding out what's going on in the system. So we checked hematinics, they were normal, and reticulocyte count was low, 0.3%, which means there is no red cell production, that means there is a marrow failure. Again, when we see peripheral blood smear, as it's mandatory in all these patients, there were no abnormal cells seen. So bone marrow, when you do, it's empty. So this is a comparative image. This is how a cellular marrow should be, cellular of a 5-year-old boy. And over here you see there are more fat spaces. So the whole bone marrow replaced from hematopoietic tissue to fat spaces with no abnormal cells. That means this is not a leukemia. This is a aplastic anemia. The treatment of choice for aplastic, this is an immune suppression, you know, there's an immune suppression, immune mediated disease, so the bone marrow becomes dry. So the only way you can treat or cure this is by a bone marrow transplant. Especially all patients below 40 years should receive a bone marrow transplant. But if they don't have any siblings, because this is non-cancerous, we don't do high-risk transplant, we only do straightforward sibling transplants, they can receive what is called as ATG treatment or ADGAN. This is anti-thymocyte globulin. It's a drug which is used for profound, again, immunosuppressive drug. So very few indications, it's used in transplant patients and in aplastic anemia. Around 60% children may respond to this, 30-40% may not respond to this. So, but fortunately this boy responded to the treatment, and within 2 to 3 months he remains in remission, and now it's been 4 years, 5 years follow up, he remains in remission. So he is kind of cured, but we always fear that at some point he may relapse. So they are on regular long term follow up. So by these 6 cases, you can already see that, and I've not spoken about the classical hematological causes of pancytopenia. So not all pancytopenia stems from the blood. It may be due to hematological or non-hematological causes. It may be malignant or non-malignant. Even if it is malignant, it may come from the hematopoietic system in which all the leukemias are involved. Or it may be a non-hematopoietic infiltrate, thyroid or prostate cancer. When you look at non-malignant causes, we have seen patients, have described cases of B12 deficiency, aplastic anemia, pancytopenia due to autoimmune causes, and myelodysplastic syndrome. And when you go through the non-hematological causes, also the list is quite long. Hypersplenism is the first case I described with chronic liver disease and hypersplenism. In fact, a lot of patients go back and forth the gastro and hematological departments for investigation of pancytopenia. Patients who are serology, hepatitis B and C positive, these viruses have a direct immunosuppressive or myelosuppressive effect on the bone marrow. And these are usually not severe. You will see a mild anemia, mild leukopenia. So that's when we investigate for viruses. Sepsis can cause marrow suppression, so we get ICU referrals quite a bit that mild pancytopenia, and these are generally not hematological, they are all due to sepsis. The other thing that we should not forget, which is seen usually in the intensive care setting, is HLH, which is histiocytic lymphohemophagocytosis. This is a diagnosis, if there is a delay, you can lose the patient. It's a very, very aggressive form of disease. Any virus can cause it, cancers can cause it. What happens is there is a macrophage activation. That means the macrophage, the reticular endothelial system, macrophages are so active in the body that they eat up your normal cells. That is called hemophagocytosis. So you will see there is a profound bone marrow suppression, and ferritin will be 5000. There is a panel that you can do to find out whether the patient doesn't looks very toxic, but cultures are negative, 104, 105, very tachycardic, but not that septic looking. So that is something that has to be picked up, and if it is delayed, then it can lead to death. It can be due to sepsis, or it can be congenital in children as well. Granular TB, we've seen several of TB induced HLH. So that's something to bear in mind. So in general, my approach is, first thing first, a very detailed history and the chronicity of symptoms and duration of illness. Is this pancytopenia there for the last 10 years, or is it something that's happened within 2 weeks? This is what will sort of give you a clue as to how serious the condition is. A complete hemogram is essential, and a metabolic profile. Peripheral blood smear, there is, you know, the whole diagnosis lies on that. For every hematological abnormality, a professional approach to a peripheral blood smear, and usually there has to be a correlation. And why the peripheral pathology labs go wrong is because they are not provided with clinical details. So it's very difficult to estimate unless it is very clear, unless you do a clinical pathological correlation or interpretation of smear is not possible. So today my pathologist phoned me, ma'am, yesterday the count was 2000, today it's 6000. Have you done something? I said, yes, I have given GCSF, so it has gone up. So he can clearly report, yes, if I'm seeing few myelocytes, it may be due to GCSF. So providing clinical information to pathologists is the clinician's duty. Pathologists will not know, all they see is a blood sample. So that's why the system of providing clinical details is very, very important. The other pathway, you have to do a reticulocyte count to see whether there is marrow suppression and hematinics. A bone marrow test should be done when you feel it's necessary and is going to contribute positively to your diagnosis. And then subsequent confirmatory tests depend on what your preliminary set of investigations have revealed. This may include cytogenetic tests, molecular tests, radiological. So if it is a cancer, then you need a PET scan, or if it's leukemia, you need to do chromosome analysis. So that all depends on your second. So the advantages of a methodical approach is you can select your appropriate investigations. It significantly reduces your cost of therapy. It avoids unnecessary fear and anxiety, and you can give your therapy. So based on sort of this approach, we have an anemia panel in which it will sort of tell us what is the reason. So it's very carefully chosen test that will give you an idea whether there is hemolysis. It will give you an idea whether there is a marrow failure. It will tell you whether there is malignancy or no malignancy. And this approach is generally not good. So if you want, you feel free and ask us any questions. It may be pancytopenia, it may be anything else you want to ask about hematology. I'll be quite happy to ask.
First of all, I must thank you for enlightening us, number one. Number two, in your clinical practice, what is the most common symptom with which presents with pancytopenia? Common symptom?
Anemia. They don't have specific symptoms, so they present with weakness, lethargy, fatigue, bleeding, bruising, and uncontrolled infection.
Wow. 15 years back, one of my school friends extracted his tooth, and the dental surgeon gave him lymphomycin. After having this lymphomycin capsule, 2 days after, he was having dysphagia. pain in the throat and difficult to breathe.
Which capsule?
Lincomycin.
Lincomycin.
Antibiotic.
Lincomycin. Uh-huh. 2 days after having this tablet, he developed dysphagia. Then he consulted one doctor there. He advised to go for blood test. And it was a case of pancytopenia.
Wow.
He went to below, stem cell transmission was done. Mm. Then he was okay. Ultimately, he expired a few years back. This was some of the symptom.
We very frequently get patients go with gum infection to the dentist.
Uh-huh.
They will take out the tooth and that will cause prolonged bleeding. And that's it. Then they come to the, then the dentist will realize, oh, I didn't do the blood test. Then they do the blood test and the hemoglobin is low and platelets are 10,000 and then you diagnose leukemia. So a leukemia patient will never know that they have got leukemia. They will go to various, we get patients from dermatology. They have bruising all over, they think it's a skin problem, so they go to dermatology. Or they go to, you know, they come through the dentist for bleeding problem. Or sometimes we get them through gynecologist and they have got profound menorrhagia. Yeah, so or bleeding or weakness. Then weakness means they of course goes to the physician why they are feeling weak, why they are getting lethargic. And then it may be anemia. Or chest infection which is not getting better. And then they do the WBC. So I think for blood related issues, a simple complete hemogram should be a basic investigation to be included in any presentation because it at least clear. Yeah, with peripheral blood smear, but yeah, in our hemogram we include that in the report.
All labs do not include it.
All labs don't include it, yes. Yeah, so that
is the is there any association of diabetes with low platelet count?
It's very common. This is another thing, it's been proved in papers that patients of Bengali, Northeast origin, most likely Bengali, they have big platelets. You will see giant platelets. And the machines are all international machines. They are not geared up to measure big platelets. They only measure the platelets of their, you know, their international size. Yeah. So most of the platelets are not counted. Hence, there is a big variation between the machine count and the manual count because these big platelets never get counted in the machine. So that's why.
Is it harmful to have more platelets?
More platelets, yes. Yes. Mm. Anything more is dangerous. So your total platelet is up to 4 lakhs.
Someone have 5 lakhs or more.
Yes, it has to be investigated, yes. I don't think there's scientific evidence to do that. Maybe, I mean, people are using it in dengue fever, they have used. And
it may be a coincidence because
it's just
actually
because it's a short duration.
It
by the time,
on itself. Yes, yeah. You don't take anything. So, but,
you take 5 days
but
and
at
you need 5.
At the same time, they were giving, so I think that because of the virus, it has come up.
Yes. So that is a
case.
Yeah, I know. We don't have a proof to say. We don't recommend it to anybody. If they want to take it,
it's
a choice.
They say we don't want to recommend. They start taking it.
Yes, that is why. And even if you say don't take it, they will change the doctor. But they will not stop the doctor.
So usually it's just pay less attention to that.
Yeah.
They're taking it, okay, fine. Yeah. You do what you like.
Absolutely.
On the list of your cases, I read one more case. It's drug induced.
Yes.
What drugs?
Lot of
drugs.
So I had got one case, patient, the elderly chap who was taking a thyroid diuretic for a long time.
Uh-huh.
And then he was found to have pancytopenia. And finally we came to know, we all investigated everything.
Everything was done.
But then finally found out this thyroid was the cause for his pancytopenia.
Yes.
Is it common?
It's not common. These are idiosyncratic reactions. That means they've been taking it for many years.
Yeah.
You can't prove it directly, but yeah.
That is
a
problem.
Yeah. Drug induced causes.
Some drugs are known. There's like clonidine.
Yes,
we are frightened. We know.
Now the use of clonidine
is anti-Parkinsonian drug. You said we don't know which.
We don't know which one is causing it, but then yeah, when you don't find. I don't know the Parkinson, but all the he was a very that level 10 Parkinson, lot of Parkinson drugs. Yeah, but drug induced antibodies are known for causing autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So something triggers it in the immune system. It's not a direct effect that everybody with thyroid can cause.
Yeah.
Okay, so some multifactorial,
There are many people who are taking
thyroid
diuretics.
Yes, not everybody.
Yeah,
yes.
Very rare.
Chronic PPI use can cause iron deficiency. In
chronic?
PPI,
yes, yes, because you'd require an acidic background to absorb your iron effectively. And that's why they always say that we should use the iron tablets before foods. But most people don't tolerate it because of the gastritis, so it's recommended after food. But the absorption and is best taken before food on a empty in an acidic environment. So that's why it's often supplemented with vitamin C to provide a little bit of ascorbic acid so that the absorption is much better. Much better.
There is another term, chronic Pancytopenia. What is thyroid?
That means I don't know what's going on. So it's been there for a long time. Perhaps hypersplenism.
Yeah.
In CLD patients, they are always pancytopenic because their spleens are overactive. So you will see that, you know, they always remain at that level.
They are not that symptomatic. They
yes.
are used to that.
Yes, yes, yes. Most of them, you know, those mild pancytopenias, we don't do. MDS can have mild pancytopenia for a number of years without requiring any therapy.
What is the criteria for admission of pancytopenia?
Admission?
Yeah. Hospitalization criteria?
Yeah, so I think all these cases which I described, I think initially admission and investigation is important. So anemia, symptomatic anemia, WBC less than 1000, platelets less than 20,000 with or without bleeding. Because some of them you can investigate as an outpatient basis. Depends on the symptom. If the patient looks well, then you can try to do most of your investigations on an OP basis. If they look symptomatic or unwell, then you should admit them.
Under the surgical cases, sometimes you get a very high level of thrombocytosis.
Post-surgery.
Post-surgery.
Yes.
What is the reason for that?
That's a reactive picture. So whenever there is a bleeding in the body systems, the clotting system gets so activated to make the platelets sticky and to go to the site of bleeding to increase, to stop the bleeding. So as a result, your platelets in the body are consumed. So the natural stimulation cell cycles, your megakaryocytes will become more active saying, yes, these platelets which have produced have been used up and I need to make more. So they keep making for a process, then the bleeding and everything is stopped and surgery, and then over a period of time that cell cycle stops and the platelets gradually go down.
And this also happens with the white cell count?
White cell count again little bit, not a lot. It should not go away. We do see it in cases of splenectomy because that's where your, you know, you will see all patients of splenectomy that the counts go very high after the operation. So you have taken out the spleen and the platelets will go to 10 lakhs, 12 lakhs, 14 lakhs, whatever it may go up to. And the WBC is high, 21,000, 23,000. And then what happens? They think it is due to infection and they get landed upon antibiotics. But infection...
Usually after operation, don't
it's a reactive phenomenon of the body, yeah. But even if in splenectomy cases, we say do not treat the WBC. If the patient's got fever, high CRP, high procal, only then you should give antibiotics. Otherwise, you should not treat the high WBC count because they will remain like this for quite some time till the signaling system understands that the spleen is not there and, you know, the production goes down with time.
What happens to the... vaccines in the higher
again, you have hypoxia. So your body is dependent on your red cells for oxygenation. So at high altitude, there is less oxygen. So the body will make more red cells to compensate for the lack of oxygen in the atmosphere. So it feels that one red cell can carry only so much oxygen. So once the oxygen level is low, the body thinks that there is no red cells. They don't know. Body doesn't know that there is no
oxygen
in the atmosphere. It only says that my red cells are not doing the work of carrying oxygen properly. So it increases the number of red cells. So we call it a polycythemia. So it's a cause of secondary polycythemia, that your hemoglobin may be 18, 19, even 20. So when we investigate a case of polycythemia, we ask them, have you worked at high altitudes?
Smoking.
Have you, you know, all the causes which can cause hypoxia, including high altitude.
But with regard to this question, is there any cutoff for anemia in polycythemic patients?
Cutoff for?
For defining anemia. For
anemia.
Say for a normal person, anemia would be say a hemoglobin of less than 10, if we consider so, with regard to the geographical history. But for a polycythemic patient, say in COPD patients, their baseline hemoglobin is only 17, 18 or so. So beyond, when the hemoglobin should go beyond which level, should we suspect them to have anemia?
Yeah, so for that you have to know that trend of hemoglobin. So you've been seeing a COPD patient for last 2 years and hemoglobin has always been 17, 18. Now suddenly they come to you saying, I'm feeling weak, and you see hemoglobin is 14. You would call it that test. There's a drop in the hemoglobin for him. This is not his hemoglobin. But if that patient comes to you for the first time, you can't tell.
Difficult.
You can't tell. Then you have to go on the red cell indices. If they have developed iron deficiency, then their MCP will be really low. So then you have to confirm it with a thing. But just if you want to go on hemoglobin value alone, then you have to know the patient and their reports for the last 2 years or something.
Anemia in a COPD patient is a very bad prognostic sign.
Yes.
It could be a marker of an occult bronchogenic CA.
Okay. Yeah, because there is some bleeding somewhere. Yeah. As possible. Yeah. So you have to know that this patient, for him, this hemoglobin is low.
Yeah.
For that, you have to know the patient and the reports. If they come just directly to you, then you will not be able to.
So in the high altitude, only the red cell goes up.
Only
red
cell.
Not
red stone.
So they are not in an increased risk for DVT post surgery.
They are they are a bit of thrombotic risk.
Why?
Again, red cells, hematocrit is very high.
That's right.
So reduces the flow of blood. So stroke, dizzy, fuzziness, all this is tends to.
Ma'am, one more thing with regard to macrophage activation syndrome as a cause of pancytopenia. I've seen many physicians prescribe methylprednisolone. But ma'am, according to you, what should be the correct choice of steroid with regard to this?
Yeah, it depends on the cause. So if you go for the HLH-2004 protocol, it says the use of dexamethasone.
Only dexamethasone,
Nobody uses
it.
This is more over here. If you go by the protocol, we've always used dexamethasone.
Exactly, because that is what we've read in textbooks. But I've seen many...
I don't know where they get that from.
Yeah.
But the protocol says dexamethasone.
Exactly.
It's a very clearly established protocol.
Because all the trials have been conducted on dexamethasone only.
Only dexamethasone. I've never used methylprednisolone. We've always used dexamethasone. Even in dengue HLH, it became a big thing. Again, dengue and HLH, that's another big topic because, you know, the macrophage activation versus HLH.
I'm going to ask about
dengue. No, I think over the period of time we have seen that use of steroids has actually been detrimental. So it's a very few selective cases. Everyone will have high ferritin, everyone will have high LDH.
In dengue, the PCV also goes up.
Yeah, but not everyone has HLH. So to do that thing, it has a clinical decision. So we see several referrals for even ferritins crossing 1 lakh. But that just shows it's a very bad dengue. It doesn't mean it's an HLH. For HLH, I think my two important criteria is high grade fever, tachycardia, and some cytopenia has to be there to show the phagocytic picture. Otherwise, it's just macrophage activation which is causing the high ferritin and high LDH. So that's a very sort of clinical decision, not go just by the numbers. Mm-hmm.
Do you do bone marrow transplant here?
We are doing autologous bone marrow transplants. Yeah,
you do it here.
Yes.
Stem cell therapy?
That's not licensed anywhere in the country.
Not in India?
Not licensed. People are doing it.
Doing that, sir.
Yeah. But not non-hematopoietic stem cells. BMT is stem cells, but they are hematopoietic stem cells. This stem cells for cartilage repair and this and that, they are not hemopoietic stem cells. So that's not a licensed use.
Is there any role of cephalosporin with steroids?
Cephalosporin?
Cephalosporin.
Antibiotic.
Role for?
No, I don't know.
Cyclosporin.
Oh, cyclosporin.
For what?
For rejection or?
In which condition? We are using it in...
No, I'm not using it. I'm just asking.
Yes. we use cyclosporin and aplastic anemia, where it's an immune mediated disease. Cyclosporin is a good drug. We use it in an ITP, some refractory ITPs, we put them on cyclosporin, aplastic anemia. Autoimmune
hemolysis,
not so much, but
aplastic
and ITP is
used. In case of ITP, how long it can be used? Cyclosporin?
Long term.
Yeah. Lifelong.
Not lifelong, your aim is to try and correct the ITP.
Right? Even the smaller the better.
Can be done, but it has its own side effects. So you have to try and avoid steroids.
And what about thrombopoietin agonists in ITP?
It's licensed. It's coming up the ladder.
Yeah, exactly.
Because it's now available, it's not immunosuppressive, it very little side effects. It's even licensed in pediatric population. So it has gone up the ladder. It's been used more and more upfront. Because okay. IVIG.
ITP.
That patient, I don't know, somehow he didn't come back now. I think he is totally run out of. But he sent me a report that his platelets is 2.4 lakhs. That's how many
more. Best time to do
so. Best time I told him, but he.
Yeah, so it's
finishing. Yeah, 2 lakh. So we can connect to make a best
time.
Yeah, but he's finished with so many therapies, he says my pocket is totally empty.
But he will have to give again, he will come.
I told him, but I think by this time the family, the ITP is very difficult because the patient, the treatment doesn't go as per my wish, you know, it's what the body is going to respond. So by the time they reach third line, fourth line, they start thinking that the doctor doesn't know what they are doing. So they will change the physician who will again put them back on steroids. So that cycle goes on and on and on and on. Till, you know, it comes. Finally, they will come back knowing that there is no other treatment in, you know, available. But he was still very patient. He waited till the last agent that I had.
Thrombocytosis post-operative, which we were just discussing, should they be treated with aspirin or not?
No, it's very short lasting. So they would say what it was said is you use your routine DVT. Prophylaxis as per your policy for post-operative patients. But there is no indication So when somebody has got low platelets from childhood and they're on steroids, you have to think about congenital causes of thrombocytopenia. So not all thrombocytopenia is ITP. And especially those who have been refractory to many things, and especially in the children, you have to look at congenital causes of thrombocytopenia.
No,
that is anemia. Thrombocytopenia, you have some syndromes, May-Hegelin syndrome, Bernard-Soulier syndrome, and all these which cause a degree of thrombocytopenia, but that's congenital. That's not ITP, and they don't respond to steroids. So unless it's been proven by tests, then you can't say, but that's one thing that some ITPs can be really, really difficult. So, you know, we have to... But now again, there is a multi-drug approach, this, that, splenectomy, IVIG. There are about 15 different medicines you can use. But it's always a trial error, who's going to respond to what, we don't know.
We had seen a case, ma'am, and it ultimately responded to rituximab.
Yes.
That was the drug which ultimately helped the patient restore its platelet count.
Mm. We are using now second line. Even this patient had received once rituximab, he responded, but he also had infection. So these are immunosuppressive. So L-trombopag is only drug that's not immunosuppressive. Mm-hmm. And IVIG, but IVIG they can't afford it. It's too much. It's too expensive.
Well, what is the latest drug to combat ITP? Latest drug?
L-trombopag.
But is also costly.
12,000 per week.
You think that it's costly? Costly.
It's very expensive. So it's not a long term, option. So for him, we double the dose, which is 24,000 per week. And we've used it even previously as a bridge to splenectomy. So, you know, when you realize that you cannot afford this kind of money long term, then we just give it, get the platelet count up and go. Because splenectomy is still far, by far the best treatment, most proven treatment. At least 80% chance you have that your spleen, your ITP will remain or it will be cured.
Like in thalassemia.
Thalassemia, it reduces transfusion requirements, it won't be cured. But I have had a few ITPs we have done previously, refractory ITPs, they are all in remission. I see them once in a year, they just come and just check and say hello. So it is still by far, but people are scared. When there is medicine available, why go for operation? They don't realize that the overall cost, or some are smart, they say, I cannot afford this long term thing. So they will undergo splenectomy. Okay, thank you for listening.